Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display.
Thank you for these people. God, thank you that you promised to meet with us when we gather in your name. God, as Tony opens up your word, God, I pray that you would convict us of a sin. God, that we would identify with the things we need to identify with, that we would change the things we need to change. God, that we would let your word change us. God, thank you. Thank you again for meeting with us. We love you. In your name we pray.
Amen. You know, sometimes, please be seated, things are not as strong as they seem to be. Babe, turn that fan on, please. Guy's unloading a cement sewer pipe. Oh, sometimes things aren't as strong as we think they are. Sometimes guys aren't as strong as they think they are, and guys are not as sharp. As they think they are.
I'm doing the watermelon challenge. I originally was going to eat it, but now I just want to smash it with my head.
The Mickey Mouse ears are kind of telling of what this guy was,
right.
How this guy is thinking. He's taking the watermelon challenge. Originally, I was just going to eat the whole thing, but now I'm just going to try to break it with my head, he said. I laughed all night over this video. I'm kind of cruel.
sometimes guys aren't as sharp as they think they are. We've been talking over the last couple of weeks, Wednesday night and this morning, and then another couple of weeks, we'll be looking at Samson. Samson was a guy who was not quite as sharp as he thought he was. Samson wasn't quite as strong as he thought he was. Samson had everything going for him. The guy had God's favor. The guy had a good family. Samson had God's word. Samson had good work. God had set aside for him the leadership of the people of God, Israel. Samson had everything going for him. He was a powerful guy. He was personable. People liked him. He was sharp. He was witty. He was a popular guy, and he was a passionate guy. Samson had everything going for him, but Samson was facing a foe. He was facing a fighter that was stronger than he was. Samson was fighting Samson. Samson was fighting himself. And we know the story. The story didn't turn out as well as he would have liked. Go ahead. Samson was fighting a foe stronger than he was. Wins.
Don't blink. A man down. Wait a second. Ooh. Two men down. Just 14 seconds into the fight.
Samson was fighting
knockout.
Someone as strong as he was.
That same. There will be two hits. Me too hitting
quick.
You and you hitting the floor.
We'll have to watch it again.
Before.
Yeah, well. These
and again.
Two hits and two men hit the floor.
And again.
It's ruled, Carol,
and no one got credit
no
for that.
Contest.
Huh?
So you deliver a
Sometimes we're not as strong as we think we are. Sometimes we're not as sharp as we think we are. Sometimes we don't realize that we're fighting a foe. We're fighting a fighter just as strong as we are. Samson had everything going for him. Somehow this guy was filled with a spirit, and he was filled with stupidity at the same time. We talked a little bit Wednesday night. Wednesday nights we're going to be looking at how difficult it is when wickedness wins. We love God. We're trying to live for God. We're trying to serve God. And sometimes, in spite of the fact that we're trying to stay on top of it for Jesus, wickedness just wins. Sometimes weakness wins, right? On Sunday morning, we're going to be looking at more of the personal side. Wednesday night is a little more of the theological edge to it. Sunday mornings, we're going to be looking more at how it affects us personally. That's when the faithful fail. People who love the Lord, people who are trying to live for the Lord, stand for the Lord, and we mess up anyway. I know you've never messed up, but someday you might. You make a bad decision. You make a stupid decision. You make a decision that, oh my monkey, what was I thinking? Or maybe you make a decision that just wrecks your life. Hopefully that'll never happen. Maybe it's never happened to you. But it happens to a lot of people who love the Lord and are really trying to live for the Lord. Samson is a great example of someone who's a bad example. Samson is the guy who had everything going for him. He had the spirit, he was filled with the spirit, and he had stupidity, and he was filled with stupidity. We mentioned briefly this morning, it's kind of a dichotomy here, kind of a two thing going on. In the Old Testament, you could see the Holy Spirit come upon people, come on people. In the New Testament, we find the Holy Spirit in people. The Bible says in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit would come upon people. And when the Holy Spirit came upon them, came on them, often they were filled with power. That was Samson. When the Holy Spirit came on them, often they were filled with a prestige. They were given the Holy Spirit for leadership. That was Solomon. Often you find the Holy Spirit coming upon them for leadership purposes. That was Moses and others that Moses ordained to help him lead Israel. But in the New Testament, you find the Holy Spirit coming in those who have given their lives to Jesus Christ. You give your life to Jesus. Jesus forgives you. Jesus converts you, saves you. And the Bible says that Jesus, through the Holy Spirit, keeps you. The Apostle Paul said that the Holy Spirit in you is your guarantee that you're getting to heaven. You know, some people are really uncomfortable with the once saved, always saved idea. Oh, you think you can just pray and give your life to Jesus and live like the devil and you'll still go to heaven. Well, I think if you've really given your life to Jesus, you're not going to live like the devil. But you getting into heaven, child of God, if you've actually given your life to Jesus Christ, you getting into heaven has nothing to do with how good you are. Praise the Lord. It has nothing to do with how bad you ain't. It has everything to do with whether the Holy Spirit is in you, keeping you. Because the Bible says that when you die, the Holy Spirit in you is the guarantee that you're getting into heaven. But that's during this age. The Bible says that once the Holy Spirit is in you and sealing you, you can't get unsaved. You can't get unsealed. You are in Him. He's the guarantee. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. Just like Jesus will never leave you, He'll never forsake you. But in the Old Testament, we find the Holy Spirit coming on people and going away from people. the Holy Spirit would come on people and go off of people. The Holy Spirit came on Samson. You find other times that Samson was full of stupidity. The Holy Spirit came on Solomon, and he was filled with wisdom, and he still married 1,000 wives. Not that it wouldn't be a wonderful thing, babe. What was he thinking? Yeah. And it wasn't just because, you know, Solomon was, ooh, baby, you know. I mean, he was kind of messed up that way. But Solomon was not only a lecherous pig, I would think. I mean, at least, I bet 999 of his wives thought he was a lecherous pig. And depending on which one you ask, the other 999 wives thought he was a lecherous pig. But it wasn't just that, as if that's not bad enough. Solomon let his foreign wives lead him away from God. He let his unbelieving wives lead him to churches, to worship false gods or to worship God the wrong way. Solomon had the Holy Spirit on him. And then the Holy Spirit came off him. The Holy Spirit was on the temple of Israel, on the temple. And then the Holy Spirit departed. The Holy Spirit came on Moses' men at one point and then was gone. The Holy Spirit came on people and left people. That doesn't mean they got saved and then lost their salvation. The Holy Spirit came on people in the Old Testament in a way that was distinct and different from the way the Holy Spirit comes into people today. So we can see that it's possible that Samson could be filled with the Spirit and filled with stupidity at the same time. He could be filled with wisdom and filled with wickedness at the same time. Samson was a leader and still ended up being a loser. God picked him. God prepared him. God positioned him. And he still messed up. He was his own biggest cheerleader. Have you ever known guys like that? They were their own biggest fan. And he was his own biggest challenge. Samson was a believer. Samson was a God follower. Samson was among the faithful, but he still failed. So this morning we're going to be looking at Samson. And I hope, just like the Bible says, all of these stories in the Old Testament were written to provide an example for us. Samson is a good example of a bad example. Samson is a good one to look at if you want to learn how not to live your life. Okay? You love the Lord, you want to live for the Lord. You love the Lord, you're leaning toward the Lord. You love the Lord, you're trying to listen to the Lord. How can you keep from making stupid decisions? I'm glad you asked that question. Samson had God's favor, and he had God's family. So let's start there. A person can mess up even though they have God's favor resting upon them. Judges chapter 13, starting in verse 1. The Israelites messed up again and again and again. God's people sin. Did you know that? God's people mess up. Yeah. I tell people all the time, if you have a Christian fish on your bumper and you're a contractor, I'm afraid to hire you. It shouldn't be that way, should it? If you have one, I didn't see it. It ought to be that if someone identifies himself as a Jesus follower, you ought to be the most trustworthy. You ought to be the one that gives the best service. You ought to be the one who's always looking out kind of that do unto others. You know what I mean? But I've had unbelieving contractors who were far more conscientious than many of the, not all, but many of the Christian contractors that I brought in. They were kind of for themselves. Not all of them. I'm talking about through the years now. I'm meeting some new guys now, and that's a cool thing. But through the years, I've known some guys who were just, really, dude, take that fish off your bumper. You know, I don't have one of those on mine because I'm not a good driver. Until I become a good driver, then I'm not going to put that follow me to the Southwest Church, right? I'm going to keep my follow me to legacy as long as I'm driving bad. I'm kidding. But people are watching you. People are listening to you. You can love the Lord, be listening for the Lord, be leaning toward the Lord, and still mess up real big. That's what Israel did over and over and over. And for some reason, we think as Americans, we think that we're going to get away with it. Oh, well, would you say my bad? Sorry, God. Okay, mijo, go ahead, go have fun. Oh, look at him back there with the sinners. Look, he's so cute. Look, like we're going to get away with it. Israel, the apple of God's eye, not Americans, Jews, his chosen people. They sinned, God would smash them. They'd sin, God would step on them. They'd sin, God would squeeze them. But we're going to get away with it. I don't find the United States of America toward the end of the Bible. I don't find us there. I'm not saying we're not. I'm just saying we're sure not, it doesn't appear that we're the superpower that we used to be. What happens to us? The people of God did evil in the eyes of the Lord, and the Lord delivered them into the hands of the Philistines for 40 years. This morning people laughed because I talked about the crazy Cubans coming in, or the conquering Canadians, or the wild-eyed Juarezians, or the hateful Hawaiians. I don't know, but somebody from across the border that would come across and take over. Not just come over and, oh, those poor guys in Texas. No, the poor guys in your neighborhood. People come into your neighborhood and they take your house away from you. And you're running for your life down the street. That would never happen here. It's happening now. It's happening now. Sometimes from people that we know not to trust, sometimes from people that we're supposed to trust. People are filled with evil. And then we get saved, and then we're all better. We're perfect, right? Have you ever known Christians that go to church and they come back just like the devil? Mom used to say that's the way I was. Oh, you go to church all holy, holy, and you come back like the devil. Who are you talking to? What you talking about, Willis? Yeah. We love the Lord, and we're trying to live for the Lord, but sometimes we make really bad decisions. Israel made a really bad decision. Again. And he let the crazy Canadians, or the conquering Cubans, or the hateful Hawaiians, or the wild-eyed Juarezians, or the terrible Tijuanaans. Doesn't matter. They could be crazy people from Tomé that come across the border and take everything away from you. We act like everything's just going to be normal and just go on. And at some point, this could happen to us. I think it will. ISIS will never come here. ISIS is here. ISIS is no different than any of the other terrorist groups. They're just waiting. They're just waiting. They're just waiting. That's the way we got to be as believers. Waiting, watching, worshiping. And then at that opportune moment, you talk to them about Jesus. If that's the way it's supposed to be for believers, you think unbelievers are not going to be doing that? Sometimes they're aware of it, sometimes they're not. Eve wasn't happy sinning. Eve wasn't happy until she got her husband to sin. She wasn't content just to be a sinner. She had to be a seducer. I don't mean sexually. I mean, she wasn't content until she got Adam to be in the same mess that she was in. That's just what people who follow their father, the devil, do. That sounds awful, doesn't it? Who is so wicked that any of us would say, oof, they're a child of the devil. They're a spawn of Satan. You know what Jesus said? Every single person who's not saved is a spawn of Satan. They're following their father, the devil. So just be aware. Just be aware. When God's people mess up, God will deliver them into the hands of the enemy. We've been fortunate for 200 years, kind of, sort of. Anyway, in the midst of all this, a certain man of Zorah named Manoah from the clan of the Danites had a wife who was childless, unable to give birth. The angel of the Lord appeared to her. The angel of the Lord seems to be the Lord before Bethlehem. When Jesus Christ appears in the Old Testament, he's often referred to as the angel of the Lord, an angel of the Lord. And you can tell whether it's just an angel, as if angels are just an angel. You can tell the distinction in Scripture, whether the angel that appears to people, whether he's just an angel or the angel of the Lord, by how he receives worship. If the angel receives worship, people bow down before him, people honor him and give praise to him, and he accepts it, then he's either God or Satan. If the angel doesn't accept worship and said, oh, no, I'm just like you. Angels are not just like us. But if an angel, an angel, receives worship, the angel will always say, don't worship me, don't worship me. Because God doesn't want us to worship angels or Mary or St. Jude or Theophilo. Is there a St. Theophilo? It just sounded good. Yeah. St. Tony. There's a St. Anthony, huh? You know, when you gave your life to Jesus, you became a saint? You became a saint. Does it make any sense for you to pray to me? I mean, knock yourself out, but it doesn't even make sense to confess to me. That would be fun. I would take notes. Names and numbers, baby. When? No way. Eh? I can't forgive you. You know, unless you sinned against me. If you stole something from me, you bring it back. I can't forgive your sins. A priest can't forgive your sins. It doesn't do you any good to you can ask me. If I have a, you want to borrow my red boots? Sure. You want to borrow these? Well, when I'm through. But, you know. But if you want me to forgive sin, you want me to, it doesn't do any good to pray to me. It doesn't do any good to pray to Mary. Or Jude. Or Jim. Is there a Saint Jim? James? Santiago. They're dead dudes. They're dead guys. Maybe with the Lord, but they're just people. The angel of the Lord, this was the Lord. He received worship. But the angel of the Lord appeared to her and said, you're barren and childless. She knew that. But then he said, you're going to become pregnant and give birth to a son. Now see to it that you drink no wine or other fermented drink. No wine, no booze, no Dos Equis, no Jim Beam, no Corona, no... How am I doing? Nothing that goes... Or glug, 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 glug. Nothing that you... I don't know what that is. I saw him do that on TV once. Now see to it that you drink no wine. No fermented drink. In fact, later it's going to say don't even eat grapes. There was nothing specifically evil about the wine or booze like I make it sound. But people who were separated to God abstained from drinking anything alcoholic. No beer, no wine, no grapes. These particular people we're going to find are called Nazarites, not Nazarenes, but Nazarites, separated themselves. There was nothing magic about what they were doing, but they showed that they were separated to God on the inside by the way they separated themselves from people on the outside. See to it that you drink no wine or other fermented drink, and that you do not eat anything unclean. Now, back in that day, what was an unclean thing? Shrimp or crab, or pork chops, or pig's feet in your pozole, or, you know. Yeah, anything that God said you're not supposed to eat. Yeah. You're going to become pregnant. You'll have a son whose head is never to be touched by a razor, because he's to be a Nazarite. Now, Jesus was a Nazarene, but that means that he was from the town of Nazareth, right? A Nazarite is someone who's set apart by their vows, their promises. They're a set apart people. They're a chosen people set apart to serve God. Okay? He'll be a Nazarite dedicated to God from the womb. He'll take the lead in delivering Israel from the hands of the Philistines. We're going to find later that God appointed Samson to be a judge. Not like Judge Joe Brown or Judge Judy or one of those judges. Judge Joe Pine. Oh, Joe Pine wasn't a judge. That was, huh? Oh, Wapner. There you go. Not one of those judges. He was a judge like Moses was a judge. He was a leader over the entire nation of Israel. God picked Samson to be that, a judge. And you'll deliver Israel, take the lead in delivering Israel from the hands of the Philistines. Verse 6. Then the woman went to her husband and said, man of God came to me. He looked like an angel of God, very awesome. I didn't ask him where he came from, and he didn't tell me his name. But he said to me, you will become pregnant. You will have a son. Now then, drink no wine or other fermented drink. Do not eat anything unclean, because the boy will be a Nazarite of God from the womb until the day of his death. So Samson had God's favor. God picked him. God was preparing him. Does that make sense? He had God's favor. He was set apart by the Lord God above him. Second thing, we find that Samson not only had God's favor, but Samson was blessed with a mom and dad who bugged him. He was blessed with a mom and dad who said, no, that's not what God wants. Hey, don't do that. What would Jesus want you to do? You know, one of those. Except there was no Jesus yet. What does God want? You know, they probably gave Samson on his fifth birthday a WWGD. What would God do? You know, bracelet. And probably gave him a little coin to keep in his pocket. You know, I mustache you a question. Are you trusting God? You know, they probably read him little God storybooks. I used to read those little God storybooks to my kids, read them to my son, read them to my daughter, and we'd read those little storybooks over and over and over. The story of Daniel, and story of Moses, the story of Noah, you know, those little books, and they're only like 8 pages, and the pictures are real big, and pretty soon the kids know how to read them, even though they don't recognize it, but they've heard it 100 times, so they can read the story with you. We'd read those stories over and over and over, and we'd go to church, we'd go to Sunday school, and we'd go to Sunday morning church, and we'd stay and eat with church people. And then we'd go back to church on Sunday night. And then we'd go to Wednesday night Bible study prayer meeting. And then on Thursday night, we'd go on church visitation. And then there was always something going on at church on Saturday, and then Sunday you start all over again. My kids were in church all the time. They were in church all the time. A lot of people who are in that much church grow up hating church. My kids still love the Lord, and they're still in church. I sopped out. I lucked out on that one. Both my kids love the Lord. My son's 41. My daughter's 34. They love the Lord. They're living for the Lord. They're serving the Lord. They're raising up their kids to love the Lord, to live for the Lord. Thank you, God. You are so blessed. You are so lucky if you have someone in your life who keeps encouraging you to live for God. Who keeps telling, no, that's probably not the best thing to do. Quit judging me. Quit bugging me. Everything doesn't have to be about church. Yeah, it does. Everything doesn't have to be about Jesus. Yeah, it does. I'm just doing homework. Leave me alone already. Everything has to do with God. Everything has to do with Jesus. It does. If you've given your life to Jesus Christ, if you haven't given your life to Jesus Christ, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. It all belongs to Him. All the pieces fit together around Jesus Christ. And the sooner we get that, the sooner we get to benefit from that. The sooner we get to lock into that. The sooner we get to cooperate with what He's doing in your life. Until that point, we're resisting Him. We're fighting against Him. We have no clue that He's trying to bless us. He's trying to lead us. He's trying to preserve and protect and position us. And we keep pushing against Him. When we moved into the burrito barn 4 months ago, when we started fixing it up, we inherited a cat. He told us his name is Burrito Barn. His name is BB. That's what we call him. BB loves us. He loves Arthur. He loves all the guys. Diego gets there about 4 o'clock, 4:30, sometimes 5 o'clock in the morning at the burrito barn. And we have a little mansion set up for BB. It's a dog house, and it's got a heater, and it's got a little bed in it, and TV and a remote control. Okay, it doesn't have a TV, but it does have a heater. In the summer, I'm sure it will have air conditioning. BB loves to be held. BB loves to be loved. We took BB home with us the other night. He loved being at the house. He loves it when I sit on one of the chairs, whether at the office at the burrito barn or at home. I have the same setup, just like I have here. We have a workstation. We have computers up. And my favorite studying position is to lean back in the chair and put my feet up on the table, burp, like that. And BB loves to sit on my chest and take a nap while I'm staying awake. Yeah. And I took him home, and he just loved it. He was so happy. But he hates to go to the house. And so now when I pick him up and he hears Auntie or Mama or whoever Lauren is, as she's driving up ever so slowly in the van so we can gently put him in the van, he'll start pushing and kicking and, you know. So now I've got some really cool BB tattoos right there in the shape of claws where he was lovingly saying, I don't want to go in the van. Yeah? We do that with God. I mean, we think He's trying to take something away from us. We think He's trying to hurt us. We think God's trying to rip us off, you know, like we did such a good job of acquiring all this stuff on our own. And we're kicking and screaming until we figure out that God has favored you. And if you're lucky enough to have somebody in your life who loves you enough in the Lord to try to keep you moving in God's direction, wow, you are a blessed person. You might have resented it at first. You might have resisted it a little bit. But man, God knows, and He's surrounding us with good people. Samson had God's favor, and he had a godly family. The woman went to her husband and said, a man of God came to me. He looked like an angel of God, very awesome. He said, you're going to be pregnant and have a son. Now then, drink no wine or other fermented drink. He's going to be a Nazarite of God from the womb until the day of his death. Verse 8, Manoah prayed to the Lord. He didn't resist. He didn't rebel against it. He just said, Lord, I beg you, please send this preacher, this man of God, whoever he was, please send him back to tell us more about how to raise this kid the way you want him to be raised. Teach us how to bring up the boy who was to be born. You think Manoah couldn't figure out how to raise up a kid? I mean, none of us do when we have our first kids. We ruined the first one. Shoot, I ruined all 7 of mine. I had to sell 5 of them. I got 2 left. Not really. You know, we kind of go overboard with the first one, and then you kind of feel guilty, and then by the time you have, you know, the 12th kid, they can do whatever they want, and, you know, you give them the car keys while they're still in the crib, and, you know, you teach them how to smoke when they're 2, because it's okay, it doesn't matter anymore, you do what you want. Not quite that bad. But the older kids, that's what they think we're doing. You never let me get away with that. You made me work for that and you gave it to him. You know, right? You think Manoah couldn't have figured out how to raise the kid? But what was he concerned about? God, please send that man of God back so that he can tell us how we should raise this boy the way you want him to be raised. Manoah prayed to the Lord, pardon your servant. Please, I beg you to let the man of God you sent to us come again to teach us how to raise up this boy who's to be born. The angel of the Lord answered, your wife must do all that I told her. Yeah, 14. She must not eat anything that comes from the grapevine or drink any wine. And he just rehearsed, he repeated all the stuff that he had said to her before. He just told the husband now. And they did it. She must do everything I've commanded her, and she did. Manoah did everything that the angel of the Lord said they should do because he wanted to raise his kid up in the Lord. Samson was a lucky dude. He was fortunate. He not only had God's favor, God picked him, but he had a godly family. God was preparing him. So he had a godly family. He was set apart not only by the Lord God above him, but by loved ones around him. So Samson had God's favor. He had a godly family too. Samson had, though, destructive desires. Samson was a blessed man. He had it together. He had everything. Should never fail. Always succeed. God's hand is on him. His family's around him. But Samson had some other blessings. He had a thrill-seeking attitude. Do you know any adrenaline junkies? They just live for the next thrill. Maybe it's a big thrill. Maybe it's just a little thrill. Maybe it's just Friday night. I just can't wait for Friday night. Oh, I can't wait to get out of work. Can't wait for the weekend. It's not bad to enjoy the weekend. I have no weekends. All my weekends and my weekdays, they all kind of run together. And that's okay. Lauren and I chose this life for ourselves. Our work day never ends. We sleep, but when we wake up, we're still thinking about work. We're still thinking about the laser center. We're still thinking about the burrito barn. We're still thinking about I have a sign business that I haven't been telling many people about. It's about time for me to start marketing, advertising that. I got to raise some cash because I have to buy groceries just like you. You know, when we bought this building, our monthly payment went from zero. That's how much in debt we were. And then we bought the bar so we could invite our Bible study over to do a church. We went from $0 a month to $7,500 a month. And this is how long it took. TONYCHAVE. Do I want to do this? Easy. Write me a check. TONY. And the checks kept coming. And the check. We don't have to live this life. We choose to live this life. I didn't have to start a restaurant. If I had it to do all over again, I don't know if I would do it again or not. I would not start a restaurant. No way. Would I do another burrito barn? 100 to 200 people a day come through that place. And I get to talk to them about Jesus. I get to talk to them about church. I get to talk to them about their problems. Shoot, I get to talk to them about mine. And they leave me money. Bonus. Thank you. Thank you, Burrito Barn. Thank you, God. Man, Diego and the team, those guys work so hard. They're just amazing. I couldn't do any of that. Would I start a restaurant again? No way. Would I do the Burrito Barn again? Probably way. Not because it's a restaurant. I'm just looking for ways to reach people for Jesus. Does that make sense? Lauren and I don't have to live this life. She's smarter than I am. If I had any brains, I would listen to her. But she's got a bigger heart. She loves me more than I love her. Is that the way that goes? Yeah. And we get into these messes because she knows that we both love the Lord and we want to reach people for Jesus. And I love you. I appreciate what you do here. This is part of that. Man, I hope you don't feel like we're cannibalizing this to build that. Shoot, I'm cannibalizing that to build this. But we're not cannibalizing anything. It's a symbiotic relationship. This is for that. That is for this. That's what Clearwaves, our medical office, our medical practice, is for ministry. Any signs I do, it's for ministry. Any monies that we get in, it goes into ministry. And I'm telling you guys, I'm not asking you for money. I'm just telling you, we're out of money. Lauren and I are out of money. For the first time in We're out of money. I'm not telling you so you feel sorry for me. It's okay if you do, because I love pity. But it's okay. It's okay. If I was a bad steward, that's one thing. And maybe. How much interest would I get if I stashed that under my mattress or put it in the bank? Jesus told us to store up treasures in heaven. Rust's not going to get to it. Won't corrupt, won't corrode. Moths won't get to it, won't get eaten away, won't get lost in the market. We're trying to lay up treasures in heaven. I'm not consciously thinking, I'm doing this for tomorrow in heaven. I'm consciously trying to reach people for Jesus. And I'm telling you, as much as I love this, and you guys are doing a great job. Boy, when you come to church, you come early, you come late, you come. You know, you're bringing waters with you. Boy, this is a good time. Lauren and I are out of money. Did I tell you that? If you like drinking Cokes, this would be a great time to just kind of, you know what? I love that church. When I go to Albertsons, when I go to Piggly Wiggly, wherever you shop. Is there a Piggly Wiggly? I guess you'd have to be in Louisiana to go Piggly Wiggly. I don't know. Whenever you go to the store, pick up an extra 12-pack of Cokes and bring them to church. Do that once a month. Do it a couple times a month. If you like Sprite, bring Sprite. If Sunkist is your thing, bring a 12-pack of Sprite with you. It would be great for you to start buying those instead of us. We do it for you. Do you know a lot of churches have coffee and they have Cokes? And you know how you get that coffee and you know how you get those Cokes? You buy them. Big churches. We're not trying to make money. No, I'm not going to hurry. They keep standing up back there. I know why you're standing up. It's not to see me. So I can see you. Yeah, I'll hurry up. But I'm telling you, if you enjoy having Cokes and waters, you can help that way. I'm not asking you to give more money. I'm just saying, when you're at the store, just pick up an extra 12-pack. Bring 12-pack of Cokes with you. Really, for real. Or Sprite, or whatever else we drink. You know what's really good? Those Diet Cherry Pepsis. Because you can't find them anywhere. When you find them, pick a couple up, bring them over. Shoot, I'll buy them from you. I'll roll my eyes, but I'll pay you. Just bring them with you. People bring waters. People bring Cokes. People bring coffee. The more you bring like that, the less we have to buy. Does that make sense? We're doing this to make your family and friends comfortable when they come. Same with the food. Somebody's paying for the food. I love the cafe. The cafe is a good opportunity to fellowship. We don't use those words, but that's what it is. It's an opportunity for you to hang out. Get to know each other. Find out what the other guy's going through so you can pray for him. You can encourage him. You can cheer him on. You know, it's good that you get to hang out with family and friends. Shoot, invite some scary-looking dude to come over and sit with you. Or not. But at least wave at him. How you doing? Stay there. You know. You get to know people. This is to help you. Did you know that? The Southwest Church is here to help you reach people for Jesus. Kind of simple. The Burrito Barn, we did that to help us reach people for Jesus. And the more we partner together, this is way better than Amway. You know that? I never got into it, but, you know, this guy and this guy and these guys, and the guy at the top gets credit for all the work that these guys at the bottom do. The guys at the top never sell soap, just the guys at the bottom. Familiar with Amway? Yeah. This doesn't work like that. The Apostle Paul said through the Holy Spirit, somebody sows, somebody waters, but God gives the increase. Glory to God, huh? It's pretty cool how that works. I want to partner with you to reach people for Jesus. All right, we're going to wrap it up quickly. I want to help a brother out here, okay? All right, we're not going to go through all the slides. We're just going to end here. But I want you to know that as much as you love God and as much as we're doing to pray with you and to partner with you, am I there now? That's embarrassing. I turned myself off with my... Not really. I think I did. You love God. You're trying to live for God. What could knock you out of the spiritual saddle? What could make it so that you wake up the day after tomorrow and find out that you just made the dumbest decision of your life? That would never happen, right? I want to keep you from making a bad decision. Even one more bad decision. It's not going to happen. But Samson had destructive desires. There were things in him that made him want to live on the edge. He lived for the weak.
Am I here?
I should do this one more often. I didn't know how short my arms were. You can make decisions that can mess you up. The decision that messes you up is probably going to come out of a blind spot. There's nothing wrong with having fun. But if your fun is bigger than your life of faith, is that a good thing or a bad thing? Yeah. If your decision to party outweighs the opportunity you have to lead somebody to the Lord, well, duh. Now, life isn't always that black and white. Samson loved dangerous stuff. This one last video, just to kind of give you a sense for the kind of messes we can get into.
It's the experience of a lifetime.
You would never do that.
Killed Aaron Langworthy.
Ragdoll.
And the line snapped.
Now, 25 meters above
when
the water,
jumped off
the
bridge,
happened.
She
Aaron's
died.
Bungee cord snapped.
Not really.
Sending her plummeting head first into the crocodile-infested waters
right away. That
of
was
the
just like
Zambezi
a
River
terrible
in
thing
Zimbabwe.
For me to say now.
It went black.
There she is.
Straight away, and I felt like I'd been slapped all over.
Did she expect the bungee to break? No. Did she get slapped around a bit? What the heck? Yeah. I'm not going to get in that situation. You know why I'm not going to get into that situation? I'm not going to wrap anything around my ankle and jump off a bridge. That's the same way I'm not going to get drunk, because I'm not going to have a... Kind of get the idea? People who live to party, that's not you, but people who live to party, people who live for the weekend, people who live for the next fun thing, adrenaline junkies, whoa, that was cool, whoa, you know, that guy, everybody's got one in their family, probably you, yeah. Samson loved dangerous stuff, and because Samson loved dangerous stuff, and if that wasn't bad enough, he had a dangerous disposition. A destructive desire with a dangerous disposition, that guy gets a lot of people in trouble. Not just himself. When the crazy guy messes up, he hits a lot of people on the way down. You know what I mean? We're not going to read the passages. But what happens next in the story is kind of crazy. Samson sees a woman that he's not supposed to pay any attention to. She's the enemy, right? I mean, literally the people who hate God, and he sees a Philistine woman, and instead of shunning and running away, he says, like that, it says in the Hebrew. And she looked at him and went, like that, I guess. Because he said, hey. And instead of going over and saying, hey, want to go for coffee? Or whatever, he would say, hey, what's your sign? How am I doing? He went home and he said, hey, Mom, Dad, I want her. Go get her to be my wife. On the edge of where he was supposed to be. He knew he wasn't supposed to date her, and he did. He knew he wasn't supposed to be with her, and he did. And he ended up in a big old mess. We're going to pick that up Wednesday night, and then we'll pick it up again Friday morning. When do we have church again? All the days kind of run together. Sunday, I think. All right, I'm going to leave it with this. We're going to pray, all right? To protect yourself from making a really bad decision, if anything in your life is bigger than what God is asking you to do, think twice before you do it. I mean, that's kind of a no-brainer, isn't it? Before the bungee breaks, don't jump off the bridge. But if you do it anyway, know that you may wake up tomorrow messed up. Spiritually speaking,
live for God, listen to God, lean toward God. You know how to do that? Look up here and we're going to pray. I'm going to give you a 1, 2, 3. You ready? A 1, a 2, and a 3. The 1, glorify God. Say that with me, glorify God. Everybody should what? Glorify God. That's the 1. I'm going to do like a TV preacher, holding a mic like one. 1, 2, 3. Say 1, 2, 3 with me. 1, 2, 3. Number 1 is to do what? Glorify God. 2 things. You know how to glorify God? Here we go. Number 2 is reach people for Jesus and then help them become more like Jesus. Reach people for Jesus, help them become more like Jesus. Number 1 is what? Glorify God. Number 2 is what? Reach people for Jesus, help them become more like Jesus. 1, 2, 3. How do we do that? Help them get saved, help them get soaked, help them get serious. How many? Count them with me. 1, 2, 3. Number 1 is what? Glorify God. 2 things we do, reach them for Jesus, help them become more like Jesus. Number 3, what are the 3 things we do? How do we do that? Get them saved, get them soaked, get them serious. Where are you? Are you saved? Have you given your life to Jesus? If not, talk to me right after the service. Let's get that taken care of so you won't die and go to hell. 2, if you've been saved and you haven't been baptized since you've been saved, many of us, maybe most of us were baptized before we got saved. We were baptized when we were little ones, when we were babies. Thank you, God, for people who loved us enough to try to do what we were taught we were supposed to do, right? But Jesus said, get saved first and then get soaked. Get baptized after you're saved. So if you got saved and you haven't yet been baptized since then, that's the next step for you. Come talk to me. Let's get that taken care of. What are the 3? 1 is what? Glorify God. 2 is what? Bring people to Jesus. Help them become more like Jesus. 1, 2, 3. How do we do that? Get them saved. Get them soaked. Get them serious. You know how you get people serious? Tell people what's in God's word and then encourage them to do what? Just do it. Show them how. Show them how to do it. Be a good example. When life is good, when life is horrible, show them how to live for Jesus. That's a tough one. Samson didn't do that. You do that. We'll pick this up next time. Lord Jesus, thank you for these guys. Thank you for this time. Thank you for what you're doing in our lives. Thank you for people who are watching online. Thank you for the people in New England who watch and study and question and pray and wonder and grow. Thank you, Lord, for the people in Texas who watch and love this ministry and love us and care about us and care about what's going on. God, bless them, encourage them, lift them, grow them. God, we pray for people in Mexico and in New Zealand who watch, who listen. God, I pray that you touch their hearts. We pray that you would touch our hearts, that you would use us any way you choose. God, save us, build us, grow us, bring us closer and closer to you. Lord, for the people here in Albuquerque, the people in New Mexico, the people at the burrito barn who are watching us, God, I pray that you would bless them, bless them, bless them. Help us come closer to you. Help us run away from self and run away from sin. Help us get closer to you and be filled with your spirit that we might honor you, glorify you, and please you with every decision we make. Lord, for the people in Arizona who watch, thank you, God. Thank you for bringing them close to us. Thank you for bringing them closer to yourself. God, protect them, watch over them, save them, build them in the faith. Use us any way you choose, God, to lift them up. For the people in California who are watching us, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for giving them the opportunity that you give us, for giving us the opportunity that you give them to hear your word, to respond to your word, to grow in your word, and to become more and more the person you want us to be. Lord, I pray that everyone who's watching us, everyone who will ever listen or watch us, I pray that you would use these words to help us protect ourselves from the world and the flesh and the devil, that we might stand strong and stand close to you, Jesus. We don't want to embarrass you. We want to live for you. Please save us. Please change us. Please use us. In your name we pray. And everyone said, amen. God bless you guys. Thanks for coming. Hang around for a while.